I'm sure you know about these thermal cameras that popped up recently and are quite cheap compared to their FLIR alternatives. Don't worry, this isn't a review or similar, but something actually interesting regarding these. I bought one of these cameras recently. The model in question is the T2S Plus. Its key selling feature is the adjustable focus, which I must admit is quite useful for looking at electronics. Most of the other cameras show a kind of blurry image on anything closer than about a meter away. The only way to cope with that is to attach a macro lens that lets you look at stuff a few centimeters away from the camera. With the T2S Plus, however, you get a focus ring that lets you use it at any distance between a few millimeters from the target up to infinity, which is quite useful for me. There are some gripes I have with it though. I will voice those and how I fix them in a bit. Since this is an electronics channel, let's begin our journey by taking the camera apart and seeing what makes it tick. To my knowledge, this is the first teardown of one of these specific cameras on the internet. More detailed images and analysis can be found on my website if you are interested in that. The first step to taking it apart is getting a tool into one of the corners between the plastic housing and the metal lens assembly. Then one can undo a latch located on the side of the camera and get the plastic housing to pop off. There is some adhesive applied at the factory, securing the case, so this operation might be difficult initially. After cracking it open and carefully removing the shell, we are greeted with a board stack attached to the metal body, along with the USB connector attached by a short flat flex. The electronics and optics assembly includes a PCB sandwich consisting of two boards. To take it apart, three screws need to be removed from the tapped holes in the metal lens assembly. After removing those and pulling the assembly out, we are greeted with the image sensor, the shutter, and its corresponding solenoid. The image sensor is actually located below a silicon cap, which protects the fragile microbolometers from dust and me manhandling it. The readout electronics and the bond wires connecting it to the carrier are covered in epoxy, which is good, otherwise it would have broken them by now. The sensor setup looks quite similar to the FLIR lepton sensors. Max Electric Stuff has some videos tearing these down and looking at them under an electron microscope. Links are in the description. We can see how the shutter operates by moving it around manually. It has a small magnet in the base of the plastic piece and a coil wound around it, forming a solenoid. Additionally, there is a 6-pin device under the shutter. I wonder if that's the temperature sensor used to get the shutter temperature. We'll get back to the purpose of this shutter later. The two boards are interconnected with a single mezzanine connector off to one side, and both boards are quite dense. There are also several test points next to the image sensor. I suspect this is some sort of parallel-ish bus, like Octal SPI with some control signals. I didn't try to probe these, but it's possible that one can talk to the sensor directly through these test points, bypassing the USB altogether. Separating the two boards, we are immediately greeted with a Cypress FX2LP clone. The datasheet calls it a single-chip integrated USB 2.0 transceiver, which explains its function quite clearly. On the other side of the board, after removing the sticker, a GoIn FPGA presents itself. And next to it, there are quite a few JTAG-looking test points, which makes me believe that the gateway on this camera can be modified. This can open the doors for community open-source firmware. The only problem is that the FPGA here is quite small in terms of the amount of logic elements. The back of the PCB with the sensor contains what looks like a flash memory, an LDO with a lot of MLCC decoupling, a transistor to drive the solenoid, and what looks like termination resistors. The LDO suggests that the sensor might be sensitive to noise on its power supply rails, so trying a better LDO or feeding it a clear supply might improve the noise characteristics of this camera. Additionally, not cooking the sensor with an LDO directly behind it might be beneficial. Before we continue to the meat of this video, I would like to thank PCBWay for allowing me to get my hands on this camera by sponsoring me. Without their support, I probably wouldn't have taken such an expensive tool apart and messed with it for you all to see. If you need some PCBs, or CNC, 3D printing, and many other services for a project of your own, PCBWay can manufacture it for you. A link to them can be found in the description. Overall, I really liked this camera while using it. The only annoyance I had with it is that it needed an Android phone and an app to work. In many circles, the requirement for such an app with questionable permissions will never fly. Thankfully, one was able to plug these cameras into a computer, and it would appear as a normal webcam showing the thermal image with zero setup. The key word here being was. On more recent models, some cost cutting appears to have happened, making the image a mess when you try to use it as a webcam. Even if you send it the correct commands to set it into 16-bit mode and do some processing to reinterpret the stream that way, you get all these static offsets, which appear to be in the sensor itself. I will explain in more depth on how these sensors operate in a bit, but for now these details are irrelevant. The TLDR is that there is usually a routine to calibrate the sensor inside the camera firmware. and it was clearly implemented in earlier models, but likely to reduce cost, this functionality was moved to the host smartphone app. So to use this camera without the app, you simply need to mimic what the app does, which, despite what some people say, I don't think is actually complicated at all. So let's take a peek into the app. If you're going to make your own software to interface with this thing, you might as well take a look at how the official, albeit imperfect, implementation ticks. Using JDEX, I was able to get almost the entire source code of the app, which is surprising, considering it's common practice to minify and otherwise obfuscate the source code of Android apps to make this sort of snooping around less fruitful for people like me. The first thing one can do to learn the capabilities of an Android app is to look at the manifest file. Every Android app has a manifest file that serves as a blueprint for the app's interaction with the OS. It explains what the app needs to function, including its components, how it interacts with the OS, and the permissions the user must grant for it to operate properly. Here we learn that the official app has quite a lot of permissions, which it probably doesn't need. Some of the worst offenders include access fine and coarse location, which allows an app to access your precise and approximate location. Now, playing devil's advocate, you could argue that these might be for geotagging images, but it still seems unnecessary to me. Next we have read phone state. This lets the app access phone data, like your phone number, call status, and network details. For an app that has no reason to interact with your phone's telephony features, this permission is definitely unnecessary. Then there is system alert window, which is notorious for being abused by scammers and malware. It allows the app to display overlays on top of other apps, which is often exploited for phishing. And finally, there are some permissions which are outright ridiculous. Call phone gives an app the ability to make phone calls without going through the dialer. Mount unmount file systems, on the other hand, lets the app manipulate file systems on removable storage. And then there is MDM app management, which is reserved for device management apps and essentially means remote control of the device, including app installation. For a glorified USB camera viewer to request this permission is very questionable and raises serious concerns about overreach and potential misuse. The sheer number and types of these permissions makes this app look overly invasive and frankly sketchy. To be clear, like a Hacker News commenter said, any sufficiently advanced malice is indistinguishable from incompetence. I am not claiming that this app is spyware or that these permissions have been put in there intentionally. In fact, it's quite common for sloppy Android developers to just add permissions until the system stops telling them that they don't have permission to do something. Skimming the code further did not reveal anything particularly bad actually being done with those permissions, but having them at all is a security risk that can be exploited by third parties, or by the first party if they ever push an update that will start utilizing these permissions. Curiously, after I wrote an article, one that got quite a bit of attention, about this camera and its app, the Android application was removed from the Play Store. I have uploaded the copy I used for analysis to the Internet Archive. Additionally, you can download an APK from the manufacturer's website for those who want to do a more in-depth analysis. If you do, please reach out using the email on my website. Now coming back to the original reason we are inside this app to begin with, the camera stream processing. After digging through the app a bit more, it becomes clear that all of the important math and useful bits we care about happen in libthermometry.so. For those who don't know, shared objects, or .so files, are the DLL equivalent in Linux, and thus Android. These are usually compiled C or C++ libraries that the application uses during runtime, meaning that decompiling this one would be a lot harder than the Java stuff. Despite that, I shoved the file into my favorite NSA reverse engineering software called Ghidra, and poked around for a bit. I did manage to isolate a bunch of functions and settings that are responsible for the thermometry functionality. But while googling some of them, I found Inficam by Netman. Here, most of the libthermometry.so has already been reverse engineered and put into an open source Android app for the older version of these cameras. It unfortunately lacks the calibration routines we need for the new version of this camera. Besides, I really didn't feel like setting up an Android environment and trying to experiment in an Android app that I knew nothing about. So I kept looking online, and after digging even further, I found the HT301 hacklib, a collection of Python files that were able to drive the older versions of these cameras and seemed very easy to hack, no pun intended. So I got to work and started trying to use my camera with it. The first images I got looked like the ones shown in the intro, just a mess of static offsets with some shadows of warmer objects. But putting my soldering iron in front of the camera confirmed that it is indeed working. In order to understand what I was looking at, I started by learning about flat field correction, or FFC. Basically, all imaging sensors have some non-uniformities, including CCDs, CMOS, etc. For the ones listed above, these can usually be calibrated out in the factory, since temperature doesn't affect them significantly. However, in a microbolometer array, like the one we have here, the signal from each pixel depends on the infrared radiation hitting it. Thus, the temperature of the chip these microbolometers sit on influences them as well. So uniformity corrections need to be recalculated every time its surrounding temperature changes. In order to do so, the camera has a built-in shutter that can be activated by a small coil inside. This shutter is essentially a piece of plastic that covers the image sensor for a specific amount of time. While the sensor is covered, we can assume that all the pixels in the sensor should roughly return the same value while the sensor is looking at a piece of plastic at some fixed temperature. So in order to perform FFC, we take the value of each pixel while the shutter is closed and save it as a reference frame that gives us offset values to adjust the subsequent frames by. Whenever we capture a new frame and want to apply FFC corrections to it, we first add the mean of the reference frame to all pixels in the new frame, and then subtract the reference frame. This essentially removes all the static non-uniformities of the sensor. Adding the mean is needed in order to keep the scale of the sensor values consistent. The value of the mean essentially represents the shutter temperature we saw. If we were to subtract the values of the reference frame without adding the mean back, we would be basically removing the shutter temperature from the subsequent measurements, and we don't want that. After implementing the above rudimentary FFC method, the camera stream in the Python app immediately started showing a near-perfect image. But a few problems still remain. The first one is this nasty dead pixel. Correcting for that is also relatively trivial. The first step would be to find the dead pixels. This boils down to looking for pixels with abnormally low values compared to the rest of the frame. This is not very robust, but so far, having looked at three different cameras like these, they all seem to return the same very low values for their dead pixels, so I assume this behavior is consistent. Once the dead pixels are found, they are stored in a mask, essentially a Boolean value for each pixel of the camera that indicates whether it's dead or not. While correcting the frame, OpenCV inpainting can be called using this mask to automatically fill in the dead pixels using the inpaint tilea method. This is a bit overkill and one can probably just average the neighboring pixels, but it was quick and easy to add, so I kept it for now. You could also use something like a median filter on the entire image to deal with dead pixels, if you don't care about the image getting blurrier. So despite being a bit more complex, the mask has some merit to it. With the image finally looking great, it is time to turn our attention to fixing the temperatures, which are a bit off if we compare it with what the official app reports. However, the values in the official app drift during camera startup because the app doesn't wait for the sensor to fully soak up the heat from the readout circuitry after startup. This sometimes causes a gradient on the image in the app, so I am not sure how reliable that source is for calibrating by implementation. As I have already said, the mean value of the offset frame we get from the FFC correction is actually the raw value that should be mapped to the temperature of the shutter. But extracting this value turned out to be a lot more fun and unhinged than I expected. So if you just open this camera with a regular webcam viewer, you will notice the interesting colorful lines at the bottom. It's obvious that these are four lines of pixels at the bottom that are different. Well, these are the camera's registers. Yes, really. The host can write to the camera registers through the zoom registers meant for USB cameras with zoom. And the camera shows its register content in the video stream, in the form of four lines of pixels at the bottom of the image. The Python application even includes implementations to extract stuff like camera model, serial number, firmware version, among other things. Only a few of these values actually change and are interesting to us. There are registers containing the min and max values from the sensor. We don't really need those since OpenCV already keeps track of those. But the other value that changes belongs to a temperature sensor. Knowing the temperature of the camera, and thus the shutter, would allow the camera to calibrate itself upon startup. The formula to read it out was found in the shared object discussed previously. When I tried reading it out, it seems to drift quite rapidly after power on, and report very high values in the range of 30 to 35 Celsius. If you apply these values to the thermography calculation, the values reported for temperature are even more wrong. It would be nice to figure out what's going on there, but I found that just calibrating the temperatures with a fixed offset is quite consistent and works quite well even over a long time. So I simply added a command line argument for the temperature calibration offset you need for your camera. Maybe later I will reverse engineer how that hot and drifting temperature sensor can be used for anything. So at this point we now have a fully open source script to use this camera with. But what do we do with it? Well, let me try and convince you to burn a 200 euro hole in your wallet. First of all, there are the obvious applications of using it to help you diagnose issues with electronics. You just point this thing at the board and the problematic part will often light up, letting you know where exactly the issue is. One could replicate this with low-tech approaches, such as drenching the board in IPA or using the great squirt vape, I mean flux evaporator. But what if you want to see something more subtle? Let's say leakage on a low power board, or see which traces are getting hotter. Well, you could do that if the camera was sensitive enough. Unfortunately, most consumer cameras aren't. But there is this one simple trick to improve your thermal resolution the industry doesn't want you to know about. It's called lock-in thermography. If you're familiar with the concept of a lock-in amplifier, this should ring a bell. The idea is quite simple. Modulate the power supply of a circuit by turning it on and off, and capturing it with a thermal camera while doing so. Then, multiply each frame by sine and cosine scaled factors in phase with the modulation. Finally, average these frames over a fixed integration time. This creates in-phase and quadrature thermal images of the device under test, amplifying the hotspots, improving the thermal resolution of the image, and showing some of the dynamics of the heating over time. After implementing that in software and attaching some devices for testing, with their power supplies turned on and off on command by the software, the results are striking. You can see the hotspots that form even at very low power levels. For example, I was able to debug leakage in a low-power Bluetooth tracker. The power consumption of the leaking component was only 2 mA at 3 volts, and only a few seconds of integration time were needed to see the component clearly. Another example is how you can see the heat from the voltage divider in a pipe pico creep through the copper and highlight the traces. You could also potentially do silicon die reverse engineering or debugging as intended in the original paper. For instance, instead of modulating the power to the whole chip, you could modulate the load on certain parts of the chip to figure out where its components are. The funniest part is that this technique has been known for at least 20 years, and is quite common and expensive in industry despite how easy it is to implement, at least with modern hardware and software. I implore everyone who has such a camera to try it out and see what kind of stuff you can lock onto. Additionally, right as I was writing this video, I decided to take a stab at patching Netman's Android app to add calibration code for this camera, and within 2 days I got a minimal version working. It works quite well and without any questionable permissions. Links to the original and my fork can be found in the description. This video is just a small subset of my experiments with these thermal cameras. I will continue working on them in the future and will be publishing the software on GitHub and my website. Pull requests to the software are welcome, ask questions in the comments, links and sources as always in the description. Bye.